Please help us welcome Father Wallis.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Bishop. Thank you for this opportunity, for the priests. So many familiar faces here. It's very nice. But you get to fulfill many different roles in your priesthood. And I now have tremendous sympathy for all of you who've raised children, because I know for a fact, many times I can say, I remember clearly saying things where very literally aren't listened to, but I can promise you if something is canceled, people know immediately. I can just tell one guy that morning prayer's canceled, everyone knows and no one fights. But it's very, very good to be home. It's also, I was raised in a way where you're kind of taught doing a good thing is its own reward. And if you're told thank you for doing something, it sort of ruins it. But I want to thank all of you for your generosity in supporting the seminarians and supporting their formation, because it does require sacrifice. It requires sacrifice on their part, but also on yours. So I am very privileged to work behind the scenes, as it were, to see what our presbyterate's going to look like in 5 or 6 or 7 years. And we're going to have a wonderful, wonderful diocese. We already do, but our future is exceptionally bright. Father Gregory, the rector down at St. Joseph Seminary College, as he says, the way you have a healthy community is for us to be healthy. The way you have a healthy diocese is for us to be healthy as a diocese. The way you have good priests is for our seminarians to be good. It's not magic. It's not just we have one guy in charge and he makes it all happen and we get to do our own thing in our own way. But we have to order ourselves towards that which we're being called, ultimately towards the call of our Lord Jesus Christ. So to go back, the future is very bright. I'm very, very fortunate to work with the men that we have. So please continue to keep them in your prayers. But talking about pastoral formation just a little bit, there's a document called the Program of Priestly Formation. And it's a document that gets quoted a lot. It's a document about basically how in the United States, the U.S. bishops have decided to put formation into practical situations. We have guiding documents from Rome, which then each conference takes and adapts to the conference, and then the program of priestly formation is further adapted by the seminary. But there's several quotes that are wonderful, but one is very good, and this is what it says concerning spiritual formation, but it's very applicable to pastoral formation as well. And it states, "For every priest, his spiritual formation is the core which unites and gives life to his being a priest and his acting as a priest. The basic principle of spiritual formation is to live in intimate and unceasing union with God the Father through his Son Jesus Christ in the Holy Spirit. This is the foundational call to discipleship and conversion of heart." And it's in the pastoral pillar of formation that this comes to be seen, comes to be put into practice. Because when we think about the word pastoral, usually, whenever I was a seminarian, if I were describing a priest as pastoral, it would be something like this. He's very pastoral, which means he's kind of lax. He doesn't really hold me to account when I do something wrong. He's pastoral, which means he's nice. And he always smiles and makes me feel good about myself. Very much like we read about Jesus in the book of Revelation, who comes to affirm us in everything that we've done, right? Oh, sorry, anyway. Thank you, Jeffrey. Awesome, okay. I still got it, so good, all right. And so it is that How do we grow in that love, that pastoral heart of Jesus Christ? What is the pastor? What is pastoral but the true shepherd, Jesus Christ? He who lays down his life for the sheep. He who lays down his life for the sheep. And this calls into question some of the ways we talk about vocations and some of the ways we recruit vocations, to be completely honest with you. Because sometimes you'll see programs talking about that which will completely fulfill you as a person. That I get to stand at the middle of the universe, and Jesus puts in front of me the thing that will make me perfectly happy, perfectly self-actualized, and a perfect citizen of his church. Except for the Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Sacrifice, self-giving, giving ourselves for someone else. That doesn't always feel nice, but it's true, and it's the way to life, because that's the kind of shepherd I want to be led by. I want to be led by a shepherd who wants to lay down his life for me. I personally am very happy that we have a Savior who understands the human condition so well that he became one of us. And that is the pastor that each man is asked to conform his heart to. That it's not Jesus comes to fulfill me, but I hear a call and I step out in faith to follow him. And so sometimes there are days which are good and sometimes which are bad, sometimes which are difficult, sometimes which are easy. But the continuity of life is lived with Jesus Christ. And this brings to a second point, where when Pope John Paul II was speaking about seminary, he used a beautiful example. He said that life in the seminary was like the 3 years that the disciples spent with Jesus Christ, hearing their call, seeing how they followed him, how they learned from him, Jesus Christ, and how he taught by what he said and by what he did. And we can think also about how they betrayed him, how they fled from him, how they left him completely alone, how he was crucified, but how he came back, how he rose from the dead, he breathed on them, giving them the Holy Spirit, and then commissioned them to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And in the life of every seminarian, the life of Jesus Christ doesn't just become an ideal, but it becomes a true following of him. Jesus Christ becomes a real person. Otherwise, if he doesn't, all we can give are platitudes about him. And Hallmark does platitudes a lot better. You know, they do a lot better than basically hearing from your priest, they're there, it'll all be okay. Because sometimes the answer is, no, it's not all going to be okay. Things are completely different now. So how do I move on with Jesus Christ? And the pastoral to be the good shepherd, to guide the sheep, this is the heart of the pastoral formation, because we're not simply learning skills. If we could learn, if priesthood were just skills, I promise you, someone smart in the Catholic Church would have figured out, you know what? It costs a whole lot of money to keep a guy in school for 8 years. How can we reduce this and boil it down to where maybe we can do an online course and get them out in 2 years? We'll all be better off if it were just skill-based, but it's not, because Jesus Christ calls a man particularly. He calls him by name, but he also calls him into a community as well. So it's always the individual response, and it's always the life of the community. Christology, the study of Jesus Christ, really is the key to understanding Catholic theology. Jesus Christ, true God and true man. 100% God, 100% man. We like to talk a lot about balance, maintaining balance, seeing ourselves on a scale of happy or sad, introvert, extrovert. But it doesn't work when we start thinking about, well, today is my individual day to be a Catholic. So I'm going to do what I want to do today. I'm going to go to the priest who preaches the way I like to hear things preached. When I'm preaching, I always want to hear that priest too, you know, because, but anyway, I want to do things my own way, and that never works out. It never works out to do things our own way. But that call into the seminary, believe it or not, this is not something I share with the men, but it's very interesting, and I'll share my age. It's very interesting to be a shepherd of these seminarians, to be their pastor. Because at 43 years old, I am looked at as having great, great influence and getting a lot of benefits because I have my own private bathroom, you know? You know, I'm very entitled. I live at the end of the hall with, you know, 25 freshmen, which is kind of cool because I think these are, if I had a son, be 18 right now. You know, and so it is really, really something amazing. Now, I am also seeing that as we age, inside, we don't see ourselves as old as maybe we are. And so, you know, I think I can still kind of joke about things. And many times now I have no clue what they're talking about. You know, technology has passed me by. And now I'm understanding my grandfather, who technology had passed him by and he didn't care at all. Whenever I would play golf with him, his one wood was about this big, you know, didn't care, did not care. But to be that shepherd of who lays down his life for the sheep as Jesus Christ taught. So to get back to that original point, it's not just about skills which are learned. It's about meeting people where they are, but as a follower of Jesus Christ, and that's what's crucial. That is, if nothing else, men learn at the college seminary, is everything that they do so as a seminarian. And that is what begins to change them, to say, how does a seminarian think about this? How does a follower of Jesus Christ think about this? When I was growing up, there was sort of the movement of saying, well, we're all called to follow Jesus Christ. And it was kind of a leveling of that. But I've yet to find somebody who says, Father, you know, I want you to sin just as much as me because you're just a priest and I'm a layman and that makes me feel a lot better. No one has ever said that to me. Everyone has always had a higher expectation because I'm a priest, and they should. They should have a higher expectation. When a man comes in and says, I'm a seminarian, he should behave differently. But it has to be authentic, and that's also what we teach in the seminary, that it becomes you who are following Jesus Christ. And that's where conversion takes place, that's where living with others takes place, that's where the day-to-day grind of life begins to form men to be who they are in all situations of life. So you're not simply, when the collar's on, I'll be holy, but when I take the collar off, I get to do what I want. That's an inconsistency of life, which there's just not room for. Because the other thing that's so important and why it's so important for the seminarians to be home is that our training isn't just for ourselves. I'm going to share a little story. At kind of a lower moment this past semester, I was feeling a little sorry for myself. I just was. You know, I'm living in the middle of a swamp in Louisiana, and, you know, it's just, we don't always have our best days. And There's a guy on faculty who really likes to say, at the seminary formation, you know, at the college seminary, we're about forming good men. We're about forming good men, and then whatever they do next, they do. Whether that's the seminary, you know, whether they go on to be priests or they husbands, whatever. That's what we're here to do. And that night, there were about 30 guys. We had this big campfire. And we're all standing around the campfire, and they asked me to share my story. And, you know, I'm feeling a little down. And I said, you know what, guys? It's great. If you want to be a good man, that's awesome. And I will support you in that 100%. But you know what? I am not living in a swamp in the middle of Louisiana, not getting to watch my best friend's kids grow up, missing things in my home diocese so you can be a good man. If you want to do that on your own time. But if you want to be a priest of Jesus Christ, who is also a good man, I will give you 110%, because that's why we're here. We're here to become priests of Jesus Christ, and how honored we are to be called, and how little a thing it is, ultimately, to do the will of Jesus Christ in our lives. What a small return we can make for the generous love that he has poured into our hearts to one day be able to say, this is my body, this is my blood, the ultimate pastoral experience, to lead others to Jesus Christ, to say to them, I absolve you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and at particularly graced moments, being able to see that sin go away, to baptize a child, to be an instrumental means of marking a soul for all eternity with the mark of our Lord Jesus Christ. What a small thing that is to say yes, to make such a return to such a generous gift. And that's why I'm here. That's why I'm in the seminary. And that's why I feel so fortunate to have been sent to work with these young men, because they are giving a lot, but they have the opportunity to follow our Lord Jesus Christ, to say yes to his call, and to give of themselves so that they can hear the Lord say most intimately in their heart, it is not you who have chosen me, but I have chosen you. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me, and I am him, and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing. Please pray for our seminarians. Pray for them that they may hear the call of our Lord Jesus Christ ever more deeply in their heart, that they may be configured each day more and more to the heart of the Good Shepherd, our Lord Jesus Christ, and that they may lay down their lives for you, for me, so that ultimately, ultimately, we may be united to our Lord in heaven for all eternity. Thank you.